friend. Yes, yes.
So you seriously want to
So, sir, half handicapped.
I hope not. And just to decide.
Hi, I'm Shanti.
Nice. At least you're not getting it.
So first of all, on behalf of Prabha Khaitan Foundation and we, Shalu Goyal and Manisha Jain from Ehsaas Women of Chandigarh, welcomes you to this first session of Kalam series with author Neelima Dalmia Adhar. And Kalam is the brainchild of a social activist, Sandeep Bhutoria, who is also the trustee of Prabha Khaitan Foundation, who started Kalam in India to promote primarily Hindi and regional literature in the country. As part of the series, the best three questions asked will also get a Kalam leather bookmark. We take this opportunity to specially thank Taj Chandigarh for collaborating with this event. I now request Mr. Surinder, the general manager of Taj Chandigarh, to say a few words.
To this first session of Kalam 2018, in collaboration with Ehsaas. The large difference between this kind of a forum and other book release forums are that it is just a release, while in this case the essence is on the Hindi books, and also you can have a better interacting session on the complete book with the author. Having said that, let us begin the evening and hope you sit back, relax and enjoy this session. Thank you.
Father dearest, merchant of death, and of course the masterpiece, I say the masterpiece, the secret diary of Kasturba. I'm very keen to know what inspired you to be an author.
So, yes, Jyoti, to answer your question, what inspired me to write about Kasturba, I have to admit that I did not want to write about Kasturba.
Really?
After having written the book on my father, and the heady success that I got with it, and the kind of person my father was. Just to give you a little peep into his life, my father was one of the pioneering industrialists of pre-independence. He was a close friend of Jinnah, and he funded the Congress. Himself had aspirations to become a political person leader. The other side, the flip side of his very exciting life was that he had six wives and we are 18 children. And I am the fourth child of his sixth wife. Oh. So I have a great privilege and a distinction and a bizarre tag to me which none of you can boast of. And none of you can ever claim to have known anybody other than Neelima Adhar who has that distinction. So after having written about my father, and then this suggestion came to me from my friend Anita Gokhale, who you all know is the founder of Jaipur Lit Fest. She said, I think you're ready now, you can do this book on Kasturba. So I thought about Kasturba and I said, what a subject to write on. I said, hey, what will I write about Kasturba after writing about R.K. Dalmia? I said, no, not happening. I cannot write about Kasturba. So I let it be. I just let it be, and I wrote my second book, which was 7 years after the first one, called Merchants of Death. And in a way, Merchants of Death, although it's a fictional novel based upon Marwari society, but I would call it, in spirit, it is a sequel to my first book. Because when I was researching for my father's life, I came across a lot of material of extended family, some of whom are very prominent people today in Marwari society, and I just could not resist writing a fictional, because I couldn't have done a non-fiction book on them, I would have been hanged. So I wrote a fictional novel called Merchants of Death. So again, I was in that zone, forging along with Marwaris and their scandalous lives and all of that. And you know how as a writer, then when your mind is vacant, you are in the quest of, because you don't want that heady feeling to die down. You want to live in that intoxication of being famous. So I began reading about Kasturba. I just began reading about Kasturba, and I was astonished to know two or three things. First, that there's very little known about Kasturba. So that was a big challenge for me. The second is that I don't know. I feel that you don't choose a subject to write. The subject chooses.
Yeah, so true.
I think she just waited there in the wings quietly and said, let her calm down after she's finished all the Dalmias and the Marwaris, and then she'll come back to me. And when I was reading about this, I read a very interesting thing which kind of stayed with me. Albert Einstein, some 75 years ago, had said that the generations to come will find it hard to believe that a man such as Gandhi walked the planet in flesh and blood. And I said to myself, I said, hey, Gandhi didn't walk alone. There was one woman who walked by him,
like
a shadow, from the age of 13 for 64 years till she died. She was his solid, she was his spine. And that kind of stoked a little bit of my anger. And I said, no, this is a voice and a story that needs to be told. And that's how this was.
And you've done a beautiful job of it.
Thank you. Thank you.
So this book that you have written, it's from a woman's perspective, where you have given so much of deep insight into the turmoil, the agony, the wrath, the angst of a woman's journey in life, who's overshadowed by a prominent man, that's Mahatma. You have beautifully brought her alive. Nobody else would have done this job. You know, you have resurrected Kasturba. That's the beauty of this book. What I really want to know is why you chose to write on her. What is the most defining part of her life?
See, why I chose to write on Kasturba, well, it's not my suggestion, it was not my idea, like I said, Kabuli suggested it, and I just got so drawn into the character of Kasturba.
Yeah.
And this voice that was crying out, almost saying that you have to do this story. So that was the pathos of that story. I needed to write it and give it a form. But the real, I should say, test was, or the real, in fact, I would call it the easy part of writing was, that to me, I was able to draw so many parallels between my father's life and Gandhiji's life, and between my mother's life and Kasturba's life. So, well, to begin with, we come from exactly the same cultural ethos, because they're almost like twins, Marwaris and Gujaratis. So we belong to the same sub-caste, our languages are very, very similar.
The Morbanians.
Yes, the Morbanians. And our food habits, our clothes, our religious rituals, our ceremonies, the marriages, everything. It was almost like, it's a parallel story that I was writing of my mother's life.
One thing I wanted to talk about was that Gandhi, he provided a moral compass and guidance to the whole nation as a father figure. However, he seemed to have failed as a father to his own children. How this dichotomy has been dealt with you in this book?
There's this constant strife in every single page and in every single frame, wherever Kasturba figures. And, you know, in the book I tried to not stray too much into Gandhiji's freedom fight, that everybody knows. Like, history is replete with hundreds of thousands of pages on Gandhiji and the freedom fight and what she did. And I feel that the greatest disservice that has been done to us as a nation is Richard Attenborough's. His film on Gandhi, which we all loved at that time, which we felt deservedly got all 8-9 Oscars and everything. So without going into the merit of the actual production of the film, but the characterization of Kasturba is so distorted, because we have this blink and you miss appearance there. She's this khadi clad, head covered puppet woman who you see and then you don't see. She's hardly there.
Yes.
So I feel that great distorted image which stays with us, and with the younger generation who's not even familiar with Gandhi, what to talk of Kasturba. I feel that somebody should make a film on Kasturba Gandhi to realize that there was one other power source with Gandhiji.
I'm sure your book will do the needful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, inshallah.
And then you should project Kasturba, you know, because you can really live into this character, you know.
You know who I thought would do a great job of that, if ever God wills, is Vidya Balan.
She's a tremendous actress. With a lot of potential.
And Nawazuddin should play Harila. We'll have to figure out.
I made a movie on Harila
in
Gandhi, beautiful movie. Even the emotions have been very beautifully roused when Harilal becomes a Muslim towards the end. And how even Baal's very upset about it.
You know, I have found many, many dichotomies in Gandhiji's life. I have found that Gandhiji did not preach what he believed, because his preachings were different from his own life. Gandhiji preached secularism.
Yeah.
But when Harilal becomes a Muslim, he is devastated.
Yeah.
So which is so, it's so antipolar. It's so, you don't expect a person like Gandhiji.
Actually, Gandhi as a political leader and Gandhi as a father,
they're two different people. Because he is devastated when he hears of Gandhiji, of Harilal turning into Muslim, and he gets his bar to write a letter to him.
And that was the time when he's a Hindu-Muslim
unity.
Yeah.
And he's a precursor of it. He's actually the prophet of unification.
Yeah. But he's very upset at this.
And he says, and Bhagi makes Bar write him a letter saying, how can you do this to us in the eve of our lives? And that's when it stuck to me. I said, my God, that is seriously bipolar. That you could, Gandhi the leader is completely different from Gandhi the father and Gandhi the husband.
Husband, yes. And what you have brought out in this book is Gandhi as a husband and Gandhi as a father. It's not about...
I have to confess that a lot of the pathos in this book I was able to create because it resonates with my own childhood.
That is why you have gone deep into it.
Yes, because being a product of a neglected family, girl child, and of the sixth wife of my father, and that also sandwiched between three elders and three younger siblings, I felt that I was a typical product of neglect.
That is why you could relate so well.
That's why I could relate. And a lot of the things I've actually, I don't know, and I'm not boasting when I say this, but I don't know if anybody else could have gotten to the pathos of the character, like Harilal or like Kasturba. Because I could feel my mother's pathos in Kasturba's life and my own in Harilal's life. Of paternal, you see, there can be no greater pain for a child than paternal neglect.
That's true.
And I think all 18 of us are products of the paternal neglect.
Especially in my letters also.
Exactly.
You have just gone into the character and written the pain, One can feel the pain whilst I was reading this book, whenever I would have to leave it to attend to other work. I would just imagine, what would Bobby be doing now?
I have to confess that, when I write a book, I actually become that character.
Yes.
So in this book, the other two books are about me and my life and my parents and my home. But this book was the greatest challenge for me, because at times I had to get into the character of Ba. At times I had to get into the character of Gandhiji, where I saw my father, that tyranny, that cruelty. And at the times when the easiest was when I got into the character of Harilal, because that is where I emote the most.
Yeah.
Because that happened to me in some measure or the other at some time in my life. So I don't know if I'm boasting if I say this, but I think I had a bit of an edge of advantage writing the story of Kasturba.
Why did you wait for 7 years to write your second book? And if Kasturba had so much of strength, was it only tolerance that was her strength? Or because she could have at least voiced something. So at any point, was it that did she retaliate?
I'll answer the first question first. I did not wait for 7 years. It took that long to write the book.
Okay.
Yes, because I wrote... are you talking about Kasturba or are you talking about...
I'm talking about the second book that you wrote. You said there's a gap of 7 years.
So my first book was in 2002, which I wrote on my father, Father Dearest. The second book was in 2007 and Kasturba was in 2016. So longest title. Because... Kasturba was the most challenging book that I had to write, and there were many times when I gave it up and I said I won't be able to do it.
There was a period of 2 years when I just could not write the book. Because two reasons, the practical was there's paucity of material, there's really nothing on Kastuba. So I had to actually examine the third, imagine the third dimension. So I used all my skills of psychology and projection and fictionalizing and whatever you may call it to project that character, get into the character and be able to express the emotions of how would Kastuba have felt if I was her. So that was a challenge. And that was the reason it took so long. And I have to confess that it is a miracle. And I don't know how I completed this book.
Sometimes the time is right, so probably you have to wait for all that time.
That is also one of the things. And I didn't wait because I wanted to wait. I waited because I was unable to write.
It's meant to be.
I was paralyzed. I couldn't write. My mind wasn't functioning. And then when it came, I don't want to sensationalize this, but I often feel when I read my own writing, who wrote this? There's some voice inside me. I've written about things which I've never seen, I've never felt. Kastuba, yes, I guess you could call it that. Strength of Kastuba also tolerance. But more than that, I would like to believe that Kastuba was as important a figure in us getting our freedom from the British. Because there is no event in Gandhi's life where she is not standing there shoulder to shoulder with him. Where there were many times when he was taken to prison and she was looking after the commune, she was taking care of the children. The Dandi March, for instance, where she was the one who motivated all of them. There were times when he was in jail, and there are many periods where Gandhi was in jail, but it was totally her responsibility to look after the commune and take the freedom movement forward. And it was because of Kasturba's presence, because you know that was a time when women generally did not come out of their homes. But seeing Kasturba out there and taking such a proactive part in the freedom movement, it inspired
so women to join the army.
Your country, I'm an author as well. I must say it's a little intimidating because I'm hopelessly outnumbered in this audience. But I'm asking you a question.
You're not outnumbered, you're privileged.
I'm privileged. Outnumbered, privileged, and fearless. To be asking you a question.
Join the club.
So I'd like to compliment you for the way you speak and you obviously write very fearless in a fearless manner. But I want to ask you, because I'm an author as well, that since you have written about three protagonists till now, maybe two, because your first two books were primarily about your own life, now you've written about Kastuba. And this is a little, she's a little distant from you yourself, and you had to put yourself in the shoes and be her. Is it that you're evolving as an author now to more subjects which are distant from your own life? I mean, I would never be able to write about a Chinese old woman, for example. I always write about Indian men. So would you be able to do that? And how difficult is it to get into the skin of someone who's not at all part of your life or even linked to your life in a way? That's my question.
Let me answer the second part first. I think I have a bit of an advantage of being able to enter into the skin of another person. Because since my childhood, I fantasized about doing psychology in a sense because usko karne se, I will be able to read the mind of the person in front of me. So although psychology did not teach me to read minds, and I have to confess, I've made some fatal mistakes in judging people. Always believing that, oh my God, I know about this person and I've been betrayed in relationships, I have to confess. But I must admit that it sounds surreal. But I have written, I think it's a gift from God. I never wanted to be a writer. I never imagined I would be a writer. I started writing very late in my life. I had finished with my children and I had been married and I had two children. And it was in 2000 when I began writing my first book on my father. So I didn't ever think I would write. Although I come from a family of writers. My mother's a very prolific writer. She was. She got the Padma Bhushan the day year she died. And she has almost 40 books she had written. And her subject was romance and poetry. And she wrote in Hindi. So I think it must be in my genes. And a little bit, I want to believe that I'm a little blessed, that I'm able to get into the souls of people and start thinking the way they do. And of course, my study of psychology has assisted me in doing that. So,
Yeah, sorry, I digressed.
So what are you writing now?
I'm little deaf in 1 year because of the flight. So I'm a little absent-minded today. I'm usually a lot better. I'm sorry, you'll have to repeat
the last question. I'm asking about what are you going to evolve to now? Do you think you're more distant subject
matter? No, I have to say that all the three books that I've written is my father, and the second book, which is Merchants of Death, is actually a fictionalized story of part of my own extended family. So those were easy for me. Writing Kasoor was a huge, big challenge, and I gave it up many times in between. I didn't think I'd be able to do it. It was very challenging for me, and the simple practical thing being that there is no material on Kasturba. I had to actually imagine that third dimension, become Kasturba, and write the story. So it was a very tough thing for me to do. And I have to confess, I gave up the manuscript many times. I said, nahin hoga, I'll give this unfinished manuscript to my children and grandchildren. Someday we'll do it. So the next book, these three books are very parallel to my own life. They're very close to my soul. And I used to often say while writing this Kasturba story that this is my swan song, I won't be able to write again. But you know, headiness and fame is such a horrible malady that once you get there, you don't want to give up. So I'm already looking for something else to write on. I don't know what it will be. I often write about, think about death. I think about the prenatal, like I said, the womb fixation as I've been accused of. I don't know what it's going to be, but I don't choose my subjects choose me. So that's, I'm waiting for the subject to choose me. And your first part of the question was what?
That I'm intimidated by the numbers. I think that was fearless writing.
Yeah, that I think I got it from my
child. I had only one part.
Being fearless is, I was rebellious as a child. I think I got that fearlessness from my father. I didn't get much else, but yes, fearlessness I got from him.
Question. But my question is, you know, when you're writing about a person who's existed and there is, you know, part of history of a country, may have not been written about a lot, may have not been talked about, but when you approach a subject like that, don't you want to maybe interview people who knew her or talk to family? Or talk to friends that she may have had, or people who knew her, or you didn't think that was important to your vision?
I was advised by people who were advising me on my book to not talk to any of the Gandhis, because there's a whole lot of mercenary and commercialism that has come into them. Anything to do with the Gandhis, they want to sell. I'm not casting aspersions on anybody, but this was the advice I had given. And I don't know if my book would have been any different had I spoken to anybody about it. Because they know probably as much or as little as I did. I'm not boasting. But most of my information has come from the first-hand autobiography of Gandhiji himself. He has written extremely explicitly about everything in his life, including his sexual experiments. So I don't know how it would have helped my story or my manuscript to write. And I do feel that whenever I write, I get into the soul of the character, whether it was about my mother, about my father, about the second book, which was a fictionalization of some extended family, about Gandhi. I do feel that I am able to get into the souls of the character, and that there's another guiding voice that takes over and helps me to write.
So have you devoted any time Kasturba's actions to his abstinence when he was sleeping with his two close aides?
I have in a bleak way, because that part of Gandhiji's life really fascinated me. But Kasturba died in 44, and most of the experiments happened afterwards, although they had begun. And there is a streak of tolerance in Kasturba, which I think was a characteristic of the woman of those times. My mother was a sixth wife, she had to tolerate five co-wives. I want to see which woman here, including me, would tolerate even a girlfriend, what to talk of a wife. So in those times, yes, I have written about them, but I did want to write about it because this forms the mainstay of my interest in Gandhiji's life.
Also because she's such a tolerant woman.
Woman, and also Freud is my favorite psychologist. I think a lot of my thought and my writing is influenced by Freud. I call myself a Freudian. I know his psychology is very fractured, it's not practical, there are many flaws in it, but I do
believe a lot of what Freud has said. So I wanted to understand the sexual experiments of Gandhiji from my own understanding of sexuality. I had to keep that alive. So like in all three of my books, I've always brought in the fourth dimension. There is a ghost. So Kasturba is actually watching an experiment of Gandhiji where he has these two naked women beside him, both of them, one his niece and one his grandniece. And she's watching it like a phantom in behind the curtains. I had to keep that alive. Because I had mentioned it. No, not very, very much in detail because it's not relevant so much to Kasturba's life, but it was relevant to her life because the sexual experiment started before she died.
Kalam is in Hindi. Kalam Hindi mein hai. तो अभी तक हिंदी में कोई बात नहीं
जी आपने हिंदी में सवाल कर
मैं सिर्फ ये पूछना चाहता हूँ कस्तूरबा जी थी
जी
आपने महान नहीं थी आपने महान कर दिया आज आप अगर कस्तूरबा देखती हैं तो किस में देखती हैं या आपको या हमें किस में दिखाई देती है
कस्तूरबा सब में दिखाई देती है
वो कस्तूर आज के युग में आज के लोगों में नहीं है ये बदकिस्मत की बात है लेकिन हम में किसी में वो कस्तूर नहीं है ना हम में वो टॉलरेंस है ना हम में वो त्याग है हम में किसी मुझ पे नहीं है मेरे बच्चों की बात छोड़ दीजिए वो मुझसे एक और जनरेशन आगे है जो कस्तूर ने सहा मैं आज भी ये कहती हूँ कि अगर मुझे चूज करना पड़े अपने हस्बैंड में और मेरे बच्चों में क्योंकि कस्तूर ने अपने हस्बैंड का साथ एक मिनट के लिए कभी नहीं छोड़ा मतलब वो मरते दम तक वो अपने हरिलाल को वो ढूंढती नहीं कि वो आएगा जरूर बात मर रही है हरिलाल आएगा जरूर लेकिन गांधी जी को उन्होंने अपने हस्बैंड को अपने बच्चों को कभी कोई दुर्व्यवहार करने नहीं दिया ना कुछ बुरा भला कहने दिया तो वैसी औरत आज के युग में तो मैं नहीं मैं नहीं हूँ मेरे से छोटी आगे मेरे बच्चों का इस पीढ़ी के अंदर तो है नहीं
और तो दिखाई देती है राजनीति में
राजनीति में तो बिल्कुल ही नहीं है वो तो खाली सेल्फिश औरतें हैं जो अपना ढूंढ रही वो कहाँ त्याग करेंगे अपने हस्बैंड के लिए वो कहेंगे तुम जाओ चिता में हम कहाँ जाएंगे तुम्हारे साथ सर बिल्कुल नहीं
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank God I didn't know about you.
No, there's nothing to know. I mean, we're all the same, all of us, in some ways. So, yeah.
Thank you so much.